One of the PBA's all-time greats. Hall of Famer Norm Duke tries to become only the second bowler in history to win the PBA Super Slam. That's all five majors at today's Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Live from Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl in Columbus, Ohio.
Welcome to Columbus, Ohio for the 2016 Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Let's meet the five finalists for today's competition. Our number five seed. If he wins today, it'll make him the second player in PBA history to win five PBA major championships. From Claremont, Florida, Norm Duke. Our number four seed, who just 2 weeks ago became the youngest player in PBA history to win the Tournament of Champions, representing Sweden, Jesper Svensson. Our number three seed is making his first career TV finals appearance, from Australia, Sam Cooley. Can he become the first Canadian to win a PBA Tour title? Representing Canada, our number two seed, Graham Fall. The number one seed is looking for career major title number two after capturing last year's U.S. Open. From Cheektowaga, New York, Ryan Simonelli. These are your competitors for the 2016 Barbasol PBA Players Championship.
And welcome to PBA Doubleheader Sunday. It's the third major in three straight weeks as we roll on at Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl. Mike Jakubowski with PBA Hall of Famer Randy Peterson. Kimberly Pressler reports laneside. Our opening match, 51-year-old Norm Duke is seeking the Super Slam. 21-year-old Jesper Svensson is seeking his second major title in 2016. Randy, we've got two newcomers and the tournament leader, a diversity of styles on today's show to share.
Mike J, once again, great major championship action on tap, starting with 21-year-old Swedish phenom Jesper Svensson, bringing his ridiculous two-handed power from the left side of the lane, and just 2 weeks ago, capturing the Tournament of Champions. Our number one seed, Ryan Simonelli, bowled 300, the 48th and final game of this event, to secure the number one seed. Ryan is on a mission, Mike J. He's out to prove that 2015 was no fluke. But we get everything started in match number one, with the Wee Iceman, one of the greatest players to ever lace them up, Norm Duke, looking for the only major that's eluded his illustrious career.
His last major win coming in 2011 at the U.S. Open.
Mika needed a mark in the 10th frame, missed the 10 pin, and Norm Duke wins sitting on the bench.
We battle on the stepladder today, featuring the debut of Australia's Sam Cooley out of the number three seed, Canada's Graham Faw in the semi-final. 30 years and 37 titles separate Jesper Svensson from Norm Duke, who's standing by with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, guys. I am laneside with the Hall of Famer right here. He's in a very good mood. Now, Norm, you have had a really amazing career that you continue to build on, but this is the only championship that has eluded you over the years. I mean, this is a major championship.
Yeah, I don't know where it's been. You know, 35 years, I guess, 35 tries at it. But I tell you what, these things are hard. Anybody don't think winning a major is hard, they're wrong. And so I guess I'm just lucky I got the other four, right?
Well, I don't know if it's luck, because you're pretty good at this. And during match play this week, you were the only player in the stepladder today that beat the other four players. So how much is that a mental edge for you?
Ah, shoot. I guess it's harder to beat them two in a row, right? So I don't know. I don't want to think about that. There's a job here, and if I do it well, then I have a chance. If I don't do it well, I'm gone. It's that simple, Kimberly.
It is that simple. Well, I wish you good luck today.
Thank you. Thank
you. Guys, Norm Duke is looking to be the only second player to win the Super Slam.
Take a look at our oil pattern, 46 feet in length. This pattern yielded high scores all week long. The players took advantage of having some mistake area to the inside part of the lane because of the length.
The oil tinted in blue, heavier concentrations in the middle, filtering off to lighter concentrations on the outside part of the lane. Every moment is so important for Norm Duke. You saw in the intro, he tapped his banner. This is the one he's missing. Out of Claremont, Florida, Hall of Famer Norm Duke begins the Players' Championship. With a strike.
And with only two right-handers on the telecast today, nobody better at blending out and creating a really good ball reaction for himself than Norm Duke.
21-year-old Jesper Svensson just turned 21 a couple of weeks ago. Three titles, including his first major live on ESPN 2 weeks ago at the Tournament of Champions, the youngest ever to do it, opening shot. Twin spinner from the left side. And Messenger! Yeah! Real late!
And even with the urethane bowling ball, Norm Duke using asymmetrical, really strong piece of equipment. Jesper Svensson using urethane and still gets the messenger. Watch, the head pin goes to the sidewall, and it comes a hunting for that seven pin. And persistence pays off.
Dream come true for Svensson to take on one of the all-time greats, Norm Duke, second frame. Double.
He's an amazing young man and just a pleasure to talk with, and he's a lot of fun to watch.
If a player leaves and converts the 7-10 split on today's show, he will earn the $100,000 ultimate spare bonus courtesy of Ultimate Bowling. Duke in the second frame, right hit, almost saw a 7-10 there, 10 pin.
Wow, Mike, it was almost like you had a crystal ball in front of you with the call on the ultimate 7-10.
Much easier spare.
And here's the difference early on in the match. It's all about pin carry, and that's what's so difficult when you're going up against the high power guys. Norm Duke, messenger, head pin goes in front of the 10 pin. Seven falls, and instead of a double, it's strike, nine spare with a conversion.
Spare for Duke. Randy, absolutely every extreme you can think of. Age, experience, number of titles, approach to the game. I don't know that we've had a match on TV that's featured a greater disparity in all of those elements.
Well, and that's true. And normally under regular circumstances, you would favor Norm Duke in this matchup. But Jesper Svensson is anything but normal. Just 2 weeks ago, winning his first major, winning back in the World Series of Bowling, Jesper Svensson is not afraid.
Light and a seven pin for Duke.
Carbon copy of the shot on the right lane, except this time it's the seven pin that doesn't fall. The players had very little trouble getting to the pocket all week. It was all about pin carry.
Spare for Duke. He never felt like he had the advantage. He gutted his way to this championship final the entire time. That's what it took for me to get here. Can he gut through this opening match with Jesper Svensson? Svensson, the lead in the opening double, standing up in the third frame. PBA's Rookie of the Year.
Powerful strike.
Thank you. Sweden's Jesper Svensson winning at the Fire Lake PBA Tournament of Champions. 234.73 average over 48 games here with a 16-7-1 match play record and a member of the upcoming Silver Lake Adam Splitters as they will bowl the 2016 PBA League. And a messenger and two bang-bang hits, fourth frame. And a mixing strike, a messenger strike, pack-pack, and he has that hit as well.
And it's just the difference is in the power. And you know, his urethane bowling ball goes through the pins like a cannonball going through popcorn. Watch this.
Norm dealing with a pinched nerve in his neck at the Tournament of Champions a couple weeks ago. Has recovered from that, but every once in a while, a twinge.
Six neatly dispatches the 10-pin strike for Norm in the fourth. He trails by 31. Never having had the advantage for the run, same story here, Randy. He needs to find a way to score the highest he can. Here's what he's got in his bag, the Hyper Cell Skid. The 9-point rating is on a scale of 10, indicating hook potential.
Stay in it, come on.
Norm just needs to figure out a way to get his ball to finish high flush because his pocket and margin for error in terms of knocking all 10 down at the same time, very small.
Ran that one out, classic Duke.
That's just a little bit right of where he was almost leaving the pocket, 7-10s. So a little bit right of that is good, left of that is good, but that weak 10 zone, bad.
Jesper Svensson saying, hey, I'm feeling a little more comfortable. It's good to have a couple of days after the Masters to process what happened at the Tournament of Champions. Jesper winning and then not making the match play field at the Masters. And back and form here at the Players. And that is in the nose. First error, and it's a split.
That shot there almost looked like it hooked early. Going through the nose, and he pays the price leaving the split. The 4-7-10. He's trying to try to get the ball over into this area and drive that 4-pin over into the 10-pin.
Just like that! And when you slide it over, you earn the Hammer Tough Spare Replay.
Just a phenom. He's fearless. When Norm's sitting there watching that 4-7-10, Norm's thinking, okay, I got a shot at getting back into this match. Instead, Jesper slides the four over and converts the big split.
Follows it up with a late timber on the seven. Svensson with the lead, and Norm Duke's mother is his number one fan. Stay tuned for more on that special relationship. Return to Columbus, Ohio for the PBA Players Championship, and let's review how our five finalists made this stepladder final. Extra frame tournament highlights heading into the position round. Grant fought, led by 13.
But it was all about Ryan Simonelli and perfection. Ryan bowls 300 to secure the number one seed.
Graham Faw, the number two seed, Sam Cooley and Jesper Svensson would do battle in the 3-4 matchup, but nothing changed. Cooley remaining number three and Jesper Svensson number four.
Jesper wins 267-246.
The real drama coming in the 5-6 matchup, Duke Archer.
Norm Duke can double in the 10th to force DJ to double in the 10th. He goes strike flat 10. It's all DJ Archer now. He needs a strike to advance to the telecast. Instead, it's through the nose. He leaves a 3-6-10. DJ Archer finishes 7th. Anthony Pepe 6th. And Norm Duke captures the 5th and final spot.
As Norm Duke's great career moves closer to its inevitable conclusion, every tournament, every chance to win means so much more to Norm and for Norm's family.
At my age, to know that your mom is behind you, physically. Family's always going to be a special part of your growing up, your maturity. But to know that your mom is in the back watching you, physically watching you at 51, you know, first of all, I'm not going to be bowling that much longer. And she may not want to come and watch me when, you know, I get to a point where people start feeling sorry for me. But at this moment, the family influences everything. And to look back and see my mom, doesn't get any better than that. Almost like having your son back there. That's pretty cool too.
The relationship with Norm and Martha, special.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, I'm teared up just watching that piece. I don't know how Norm can pick himself up out of the chair after watching that and throw a shot. But yeah, that was a pretty special piece there.
Norm feels so deeply about family and this game. This title means so much. He trails by 18, but he can cut into the lead, sixth frame. And it's an 8-pin Svensson advantage.
One more strike here in the seventh. Norm Duke takes the lead. Again, another shot that was in that half pocket zone. A little bit left of that, it's a flat 10 or a possible pocket 7-10. We've almost seen Norm leave that twice in this game. But he's hasn't missed the pocket. 10-pin in the second, 7-pin in the third. Working on a three-bagger. One more, he takes the lead.
Never felt like he had the advantage at any point in this tournament. He can take a small advantage here with a strike. Seventh frame. Down to a knee! 10-pin to its knees! Duke in the lead!
Norm finally got a break with Gary right here. As we take a look at our Barbasol close shave of the day, Norm Duke in that half pocket zone, weak 10 shot, 6-pin to the side, it stands up, leans into the 10-pin, and that's a four-bagger and a new leader in match number one.
First pressure on Svensson, he's got a strike, working can take the lead right back in his seventh frame. Bang! No doubt strike for Svensson.
Boy, the youngsters that we've been watching the last month or so on tour are just truly amazing and just so mentally sharp for their age. As we take a look at his arsenal using the pitch black, and we talked about it before, that's just regular urethane versus reactive resin, which is, you know, the most popular bowling ball. Most people that use urethane today is either on a very short pattern or they use it for spares.
Another major difference between Svensson and Duke. And a double for Svensson. And it's right back to an 18-pin advantage.
These young guns are mature beyond their years. They're not afraid. And they've got a lot of talent.
Norm Duke, youngest ever to win a PBA Tour title at the age of 18 in 1983. Jesper Svensson was born in 1995. And he became the youngest ever to win the Tournament of Champions just 2 weeks ago. Bidding for his second major, Duke looking for the Super Slam. Eighth frame. Light, and Duke shakes him out. We're back to an 8-pin match.
Shot. Make your shot.
Max score, Jesper Svensson, 277. Max score, Norm Duke, 269. As we take another look at that light mixer, Norm working on a five-bagger.
Give me a shot.
One more for a six-pack.
One time, give me a shot.
Foundation frame for Duke. He can take the lead with a strike. Winner advances to face Sam Cooley. Duke is solid in the pocket, and he retains the lead.
Posted that one beautifully. That ball's high flush. 51 years of age, still using 16 pounds, or as he likes to call it, man weight.
Randy, you painted the picture at the top of the show. The opening match is fireworks. And now Svensson can take the lead right back in his ninth frame. Touch high, but he carries the six.
Amazing pin carry. And this was the suspect lane. Remember back in the fifth frame, he went high. This one's high again. Trips the 6-10 late. Watch this pin action. Oh, my. Two strikes here in the 10th frame, and Jesper Svensson will move on to the next match.
It's a shutout situation. The players ask for ball in hand. Svensson, ball in hand, 10th frame. He commands the pocket, he commands the high pocket, he commands the light hit.
I saw him arriving at the center earlier today, and he said, you know, Randy, I'm not going to speak English on the telecast today, all Swedish. I'm like, well, now I won't understand what you're saying, but I think I have a feeling that the last thing that he said on that last shot was carry. Boy, he doesn't hold anything back, and he gets every ounce out of that body and frame. About 6'4" in height, probably weighs in at about 160 pounds.
He tries not to feel the pressure. He just wants to enjoy the moment and have fun. What better fun? Strike to eliminate a Hall of Famer and advance at the players. Exclamation point.
Wow. All I could say is wow. I've been doing the telecast for a lot of years, and I'm hard-pressed to remember a time when we had this much excitement with the youth movement on the PBA Tour, and it's pretty fun to watch. Talk about the wow factor back in our sport. Here's one guy that displays the wow factor. Urethane bowling ball, two-handed style.
Norm Duke gave it everything he had, and it still wasn't enough. Jesper Svensson, the Swede, moves on, and he'll face Australia's Sam Cooley. PBA Hall of Famer Wayne Webb, host at Columbus Bowl, joins us next at the Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Thrilling opening match. Jesper Svensson 274 defeating Norm Duke 258. And Svensson moving along the stepladder to face Australia's Sam Cooley coming up next. Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl, and Wayne Webb from 1980. Wayne, the host here at Columbus Bowl, swinging it low, Randy.
Well, you know, I grew up watching Wayne, and I always loved his style. It was unique, but he was a power player back then. And my favorite players to watch were him, Marshall Holman, and Mark Roth, as we take a look at the great career of one of the greatest of all time. And Wayne, first of all, welcome, and thanks for spending time with us, not only here at your beautiful center, but in the booth as well. We're going to call the action in the next match, but one of the things I wanted to ask you was, you got to watch these youngsters in that incredible power firsthand this week. What are some of your impressions of the youth movement on the PBA Tour?
These guys are so good. I can't believe the amount of revolutions they can get on a ball and still be accurate. You know, when I came out, I was a power player. Now I'm a straight player. Things turn.
Wayne, 20-time winner on the PBA Tour. Now Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl, the difference between being a Hall of Famer and a host of a major event.
I'll tell you what, being a host here was absolutely incredible. It's a dream come true. You know, I love having the guys here. I wanted to show them that I wanted them here. They're my celebrities for the week, and it was as much fun as I've ever had.
Wayne Webb sticks around and calls action with Mike, Jay, and Randy. The Barbasol PBA Players Championship rolls on. Jesper Svensson versus Sam Cooley next. Great fan support in Columbus, Ohio all week for the Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Qualifying match play, and now this stepladder final. Roltec stack, Sam Cooley, the Australian, was never lower than fourth place at the end of any round. Consistency. And Kimberly Pressler is with Sam Cooley.
Thanks, guys. I sure am. So, Sam, the guys just mentioned that you, all during these rounds leading up to today's telecast, you were never fourth position. So how much about that coming into today?
It hasn't really been playing on my mind. Coming into this week, I've had the mindset of each day's brand new, and it's worked fantastically for now. So I'm just going to treat this game like I have all week, and hopefully that's enough to move on.
Well, it's a little bit different because this is the first time you're on national television under the bright ESPN lights. Is that weighing on you at all?
The pressure's always going to be there, but it's a good sort of pressure.
Thank you today. Thank guys, you back to you in the booth.
The thing that really impresses me about these young players is power, but how mature they are. You know, it took me years level of maturity and to learn how to win on television, and it seems like these youngsters are just coming right out with their power.
Eliminating Norm Duke, opening shot against Cooley. He'll begin on the left lane.
10 down. What's your impression on that young man throwing that urethane ball like that?
That is unbelievable. There's so much power, and he's so accurate. You know, he gets these pins flying around. If they hit the pocket, they strike every time, it seems like.
On 46 feet of oil, and this oil that the tour has been using this season is very thick, and this young man's still using urethane on 46 feet.
You know, I got the ball this week, and I couldn't hardly hook the ball. There was so much oil, and they can get the ball to move even with urethane.
Debut of Sam Cooley out of Mount Warrigal. Six around the 10. Another Australian making a stepladder final.
For the first time ever. Pretty good shot for his first time on television. As we take a look at this style here, Wayne, that's kind of the prototypical power game of today. High backswing, the bent elbow and wrist, and the downswing. Kind of uncupping the elbow and the wrist to create that power. You see the oil ring on that bowling ball, that high track.
And what you heard in the interview with Kimberly is very true. Talking with Sam yesterday, he's very low key, takes it as it comes, one at a time, and a good spare.
The players are bouncing out the 10 pins and 7 pins this week. So if we do leave the, if one of the players were to leave a 7-10 split, what are the odds here of making it in your center, Wayne?
I think the odds are really good. I would have expected a lot more to be made this week, as many pins have popped out. These guys throw the ball so hard at their spares, it's really easy to get them out here.
Cool. Sam Cooley, top prior finish in a major, was 22nd. In Reno at the PBA World Championship, 239 average for 48 games, exactly even in match play at 11-11 with two ties. And some of the greatest of all time inspiring Cooley. And we will get out the special poking tool and remove the offending bowling pin. Kimberly Pressler is laneside. Kimberly.
Thanks, guys. I am joined with Hall of Famer Norm Duke. Norm, you fought to the very end out there. Talk to me about your thoughts about this match. Our match.
I fought tooth and nail. I fought my heart out. I gave it everything I had. And, you know, I get up in the 10th frame and I'm locked out. A lot of guys in the 10th frame were locked out. When the left-handers, they get it. When they get it going, you can't beat them. And so I look for a high-scoring match. I tell you what, our side is getting better. Another game or two, and I think that we can play with them. But right now it's about Kerry, and man, they just have so much rev rate over there. I like the left.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Guys, back to you.
Good strike for Cooley. Svensson trying to double up and take the lead early. Touch high, 247.
And he's been high three times on this right lane now, and it looks like he's got a little bit of early check on that right lane, Wayne, even with the urethane bowling ball.
Well, you know, they sand these balls and they start breaking down the front part of the lane. He's going to have to start moving right, make up for the front part.
Covers a spare.
Skinny jeans on the 247 conversion. His opponent, Sam Cooley, the last right-hander on the telecast. The rest of the way is going to be all southpaws, but none of the other southpaws using urethane. You know, urethane tends to carry oil down the lane as opposed to reactive resin, which absorbs oil. And if this young man can get through this match, he might be tough to beat for the other two left-handers.
Absolutely. As long as he can, yeah, those fronts are going away a little bit. He's just got to make that little bit of move, and he'll be okay.
Six pin for Svensson.
He's used to seeing this, though, because his A game is throwing urethane. He sticks to his game plan, which is urethane, urethane, and more urethane. In fact, he's got seven urethane bowling balls here with him this week.
Well, I think that's the big key, is he's going to know how to make that move and not going to get in too much trouble.
Right, and he's seen this before. He's seen where the fronts go. He knows what reaction to make. The question is, as good as the lanes are on both sides, the right side's still good. Is Sam Cooley going to start stringing him and run away from Jesper Svensson? I know it's early, but first shot on the right lane was a ring and 10 for Sam. As we take a look at his arsenal, he's using the Dream On.
Third frame for Cooley, earns his first double.
This is the power player of today. They get that high arm swing, and all the revolutions are from behind the ball, so it reads the mid lanes properly, also makes that ball enter the pins better, so that's what's increasing their carry.
In talking with these power players, I asked them, what is it you're trying to get your bowling ball to do? And they all say the same thing, trying to get it to roll early.
Absolutely.
Big difference between rolling early and hooking early. They try to get the bowling ball to roll early, it reads the mids, it comes off the end of the pattern nice and smooth, entry angle in the pocket's perfect for maximum carry.
11 pin lead for Sam Cooley early, fourth frame. Second arrow, the arrows, and spare, and three good strikes. Norm Duke alluded that the lanes could be favoring that direction.
Well, and that's that hot half pocket hit that Norm Duke lost early in the first match. And this is the difference in power. As you see, the six pin just goes to the sidewall and slaps the 10 silly.
Cooley spare and three strikes. Svensson strike and two spares working in the fourth frame. He trails by 21.
Tried.
And we'll get a reset from Svensson. A lot of chat about the two-handed game, and according to Svensson, he said, very matter-of-factly, some people like it, some don't, and that's just the way it's going to be. After the reset, very confident young man strides and toes the line here, fourth frame.
Beautiful shot. You know, Wayne, that's his thing, throwing the urethane ball. When Amleto Monicelli first came out on tour, as you remember, how many people tried to change his game?
Everybody tried to change his game because he thought his arm swing was too high, he hooked it too much, and look at it now, and Amuleto's one of the guys that's lasted the longest out here.
Yep. Hall of Famer, just won the Japan Cup not long ago, beating all the young guys. I like this kid. He sticks to his guns, and he does what he feels comfortable doing, and that's throwing urethane his way.
Monicelli notched his 20th PBA Tour win to equal that of Wayne Webb. Fifth frame. And a double cutting into the Cooley lead. It's now 11 pins.
Even back in the day when you and I used urethane, did we ever get it to hit like that?
I don't remember that. You know, when it was half pocket like that? That was a 10 pin.
The only time we ever got our urethane balls to hit like that, Wayne, was when we bowled on 22 feet of oil.
Watch the four pin, second from the left, go to the sidewall and just crush the seven. Get out of my face.
Jesper Svensson responds with the double coulee. Turkey working, bottom of the fifth. Oh, solid nine.
Spoke with Jason Belmonte a couple of nights ago in regards to Sam Cooley, and Jason said, Sam is one of the biggest practicers I've ever seen in my life. He does, all he does is bowl, 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 as we see the bowling ball go right by the nine pin.
Cooley said it's a good feeling to represent Australia. It's tough to follow in Belmo's shadow, but it's a good pressure, as he reiterated earlier with Kimberly Pressler.
Wayne, I was always a big practicer. I don't know how much practicing you used to do, but, you know, I was one of those guys that was kind of a technical guy. I was working on my swing, as you know, and when I asked Sam, I said, well, what in particular do you work on? And he said, I work on everything. Timing, swing, footwork, everything.
Every time I went out and practiced, and I did practice a lot, and I bowled with David Ozio, he was the king of practice. And, you know, it was always, for me, it was always trying to throw the ball a lot of different ways, because I had to learn to be able to go straight, hook the ball, whatever I needed to do.
Sam has worked to get the ball lower in his setup with more deep end and the bent forward at the start of the swing. Six frame. Stepped out just a touch and a flat 10.
Well, thus far through a game and a half, the only person to miss the pocket has been Jesper Svensson. Norm Duke never missed the pocket. Sam Cooley hasn't missed the pocket. Right now, the only issue for Sam Cooley is the pin carry. Ringing 10 in the first, solid 9 in the fifth, swishing 10 in the sixth.
Spare for Sam Cooley, the Australian, in his American television debut, has taken a 9-pin lead on Jesper Svensson. Svensson can take the lead when we return to Columbus, Ohio. Mike Jakubowski, PBA Hall of Famers Randy Peterson and Wayne Webb with Kimberly Pressler as the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions rolls on this PBA doubleheader Sunday. Key shot out of the break and a chance to take the lead for Svensson.
I think he's going to make a great shot here. He's already made the move.
Sixth frame. Mixing comes up short.
Interesting, that one didn't pick up.
Wayne, how did you handle that first shot out of the break? Always the toughest.
Yeah, I really didn't ever have that much problems with coming out of the break. It was just one of those times you had a chance to think a little bit and regroup again.
So now a 3-6 conversion. Attempt by Svensson.
Whoa,
clicks it.
Well, Wayne, it's not how, it's how many, and he catches just enough of the six pin there for the spare conversion.
I think this is the key point. You know, I think he's starting to get a little over-under in the front, and he's got to get lined up.
The move for me would be, with that bowling ball, would be to move my eyes in and go straighter.
Right.
And another reset, seventh frame.
Distraction from someone in the crowd.
As you mentioned, Randy, it might not be the same pitch black. He's got seven different layout options with seven different urethane balls.
Yeah, you know, back when Wayne and I were youngsters on the tour, we had two different drillings, positive leverage and negative leverage.
Roller, no.
So we used our urethane bowling balls and we either had an extra hole in them or we didn't have an extra hole in them. And I think back then, Wayne, if we had more than 10 bowling balls, people started to question what we were into.
Well, back then, you know, it was more about hand releases and trying to make the ball do a lot of different things with less balls.
Bairford's fence, and he trails by 12. And now the key frame here is for Cooley. The spare and then the convincing turkey, couple nine counts for Cooley and his first shot after the break.
Well, this is where he needs to impose his will and throw a double and increase his lead to 22.
Talking with Cooley yesterday, just loves bowling. Pro bowling is what I really want to do, and he's really doing it right now. Seventh frame. Right. Mixer.
Yeah, let's take a look at our track tech talk and the game of Sam Cooley. And as Wayne Webb alluded to earlier, the prototypical power game, you see this left arm nice and straight out in front of the player in the high backswing. And then the follow through that goes what appears to be to the inside. But Wayne, we were talking during the break, and the new power players of today, their bodies get so open that follow through appears to go to the inside. It's actually a lot straighter than it looks. And if it didn't go in that direction, these players would throw it in the left and right gutters, respectively.
Seven-pin erased, and just like Randy said, he imposed his will there, double to increase his lead.
I think that's where you see where Norm Duke has broken down the lanes a little bit, going straight for the righties, and he's got a little spot to throw it at right now.
Remember the solid nine-pin in the fifth frame? Made up for it a little bit right there.
Oh, yeah.
Svensson in need of a strike. He trails by 22, eighth frame. And he gets it. Mixer. PBA's Extra Frame is your home for exclusive live coverage of PBA Tour, PBA 50 Tour, and PWBA Tour events. The newly revamped video subscription service will feature more than 1,000 hours of live coverage in 2016. Don't miss a minute of the action. Click on the Extra Frame link at PBA.com for more information.
Must strike situation here for Jesper Svensson. He can strike out for 236. Sam Cooley is already in the 220s, but no matter what Jesper does, he cannot shut out Sam.
Mixing, no.
I think that's where you see that the fronts have got him a little bit right now, and with this long pattern at 46 feet, you know, as soon as he starts to get in and using urethane, it's hard to get around it.
And being the only lefty in the first two matches, the front part of the lane still broke down that much with that urethane ball.
And he's carrying it down on himself.
What do you anticipate the ball reaction is going to be like for Ryan Simonelli and Graham Faw?
Well, you know, Ryan's a little bit further left of him. I think he'll be okay. Faw might be in the same spot, and he'll probably be able to get around it.
The winner of this match advances to the semifinal to face Canada's Graham Faw, who will make his debut. Cooley with a lead, foundation frame.
Convincing strike.
If the left side reacts the same for our last two southpaws, with early hook up front, oiled down the lane to where if the lefties miss a little bit to the outside, the ball hangs, this could be a runaway for Sam Cooley.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm seeing right now, because it's like I said, with Norm Duke breaking that shot down to the right a little bit, he's got a little extra room to throw it to the right that's already burned up. And Norm's not going to get it carried down too bad. If the left side shows that carry down, that early hook, they could be in trouble.
Sam Cooley, as Svensson did before him, looking out to lock out his opponent, 10th frame.
Light mix and strike.
Come
Sam
on!
Cooley advances to the players' semifinal.
That's the most excited we've seen Sam Cooley all week.
Yes. Very, very even. When he says, I just take it a day and a round at a time, he means it.
He does mean it, and so much talent, it's unbelievable.
So he will consider the next match another round and another reset. He doesn't want to have a preconceived idea from day to day or from match to match.
See, that's the key right there. He leaked that just a tiny bit, but it looks like he also missed it at the bottom. He's got that extra spot to throw it at.
That was a little area check there.
There it was.
PBA Hall of Famer Wayne Webb, we appreciate you joining us for this match, and also thank you so much for your support of this event. And it's a pleasure to come to Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl.
Oh, it was great. I had so much fun. The players were absolutely great to me. So appreciative of being here. I hope they come back.
Sam Cooley opting for the strike line, and he will continue. Cooley versus Canada's Graham Faw making his debut. Sam Cooley, the winner, moving on at the Barbasol PBA Players Championship.
Wayne, thanks for all the great hospitality, my friend.
Oh, thank you.
Tonight, after the Lakers and Bulls, stick around for SportsCenter at Night with Bucci and Levy. I'll have all the highlights from the Daytona 500, Riviera Country Club, the NBA, NHL, college basketball, the latest news from spring training. SportsCenter at Night tonight, after Lakers-Bulls right here on ESPN, and streaming live on Watch ESPN and on the ESPN app.
Lakers and Bulls? You mean Magic and Jordan?
No, Derrick Rose and the rest. Let's flash back with Ebonite to the 1996 Touring Players Championship.
Albie got off to a great start throwing the front six, but here comes Parker Bone III slinging it off the left gutter. He finishes with the last seven. Albie now needs a double in the 10th. How about this pin carry? Perfect in the pocket there, and this for the Super Slam.
To win the Super Slam is Mike Albee. Barbasol PBA Players Championship rolls on. Sam Cooley defeats Jesper Svensson 246-206 and moves along. Cooley, in his debut, meets Canada's Graham Faw, making his debut. Semifinal action. Righty Sam Caw. Sam Cooley against lefty Graham Faw when we return to Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl.
Easy for you to say.
The great Hall of Famer Johnny Petraglia with PBA Tour Commissioner Tom Clark on the 50th anniversary of his first win, honored here last night with the 45th Brunswick Service Award.
45 years with Brunswick, and Johnny Petraglia signed me to my first ever staff contract. And he's been a great friend for a very long time, and what a great player.
Coming up later today on NBA Sunday, we've got two compelling games for you. 3:30 Eastern on ABC. King James and the Cavs square off against KD. Russell Westbrook and OKC in the Thunderdome. And at 8 on ESPN, Kobe and the Lakers take on Derrick Rose and the Bulls at the United Center. All starts at 3 with NBA Countdown, and both games can be seen streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
So it's not going to be Magic and Jordan?
It will not be.
Okay.
But I do know that Kimberly Pressler is standing by with the Canadian, Graham Faw. Kimberly.
Thanks, guys. Graham, this is only your second PBA tournament that you've ever competed in. Can you believe you've made it this far, this quickly?
Absolutely not. Right after the Masters, it was a slow showing, but I'm glad I was able to redeem myself this week, and I hope I can translate that to Stevie.
Well, let's talk about the Masters real quick, because Dan McClellan, he's a Canadian. You bowl with him in Canada. You guys are on league together, and you guys are pretty good friends. He placed second last week. Did he give you any advice for today?
Absolutely. He texted me quite a lot yesterday, just giving me pointers about TV, how they break down, how to handle myself. So I'm hoping to use those and bowl well.
All right, well, good luck to you, Dave. Guys, Graham Faw is looking to hopefully become the first ever Canadian to win a PBA title.
Thanks, Kimberly. Two international players making their debut from Mount Warrigal in New South Wales, Australia. It's Sam Cooley from Guelph, Ontario, Canada. It's Graham Faw. Faw, the number two seed, has indicated that Sam Cooley will begin. The right-hander will get the left lane in our semifinal.
And right out of the interview is when the meat sweats start. You get to sit back down in that chair. Sam Cooley, he's got a game under his belt. He's confident. He's comfortable. He's got a great ball reaction. We'll see how Graham Faw handles the pressure of the bright lights of the PBA Tour.
Cooley opening pitch in the semifinal. Dead perfect strike.
Filthy. Got a great look. If his ball does check early, he knows exactly what the move is. Just kind of inch it in just a little bit. Keep his lines nice and tight and straight in front of him.
Pay no attention to the consonants. It's pronounced Graham Faw. He's of German descent, Canadian from Guelph, Ontario, Canada, making his American television debut and second event as a professional. Opening shot for the left-hander. Light mixer, nine pin.
There we see that late ball reaction on the left side of the lane created by the urethane bowling balls that Jesper Svensson was throwing for two games. It's a nice looking game here. He keeps his hand underneath the, and up the back of the bowling ball, but you can see it gets down to the end of that pattern, Mike J, and it doesn't want to make the turn into the pocket.
Faw picks up the spare. Randy, he really does his homework. Before each round of competition, he studies the lane assignments and he makes his move off what other lefties are doing before him. So you would think he would do the same thing here today.
Right, exactly. If he was following urethane, he knew he had to move to the left because urethane creates carry down. If he followed, say, Simonelli, he knew that Simonelli would break the lanes down and he would have to move more towards the center part of the lane. Right now, he's just finding a way to get through that carry down on the left side.
Good slides shot. Out the 10. First strike for Graham Faw.
Remember, there's not only carry down on the left side from the urethane that Jesper was using, but there's also a little breakdown in the front part of the lane.
Interesting part of Sam Cooley is back home in Australia. He works with an agency that assigns clients, and he helps those clients with their daily life duties, including cooking, and a very interesting profession for the young man. He's looking for further opportunities in the future. Another good shot for Cooley, opening double in the semifinal.
Sam Cooley bowls a lot in Asia. This is his fourth time in the States competing. As we take a look at some of our other finishers,
Anthony Pepe.
Excuse me, Mike. Yeah, I was going to mention Kyle Troop. What a three-week major run he had, almost making the telecast in all three majors.
Wes Mellott finishing 10th. 24 players making the match play field here in Columbus. Cooley strong. Opening turkey.
Cooley might not stop striking until next Wednesday.
Very even demeanor, and Cooley cool thus far, opening turkey. Now Graham Faw, spare and a strike. He likes to go straight and further right on this pattern. He considers himself a less powerful power player. And light again, this time the front pin instead of the back.
Another light shot on the right lane. So what's the adjustment? Well, the adjustment is to keep your lines straighter or go to a stronger piece of equipment. However, if you do that, you run the risk of that stronger bowling ball checking early. It's all about getting through the front part of the lane without the ball hooking and then making sure that it recovers down lane.
And the rest of our match play field, the negative number indicates position from the fifth place on our show. E.J. Tackett with another nice run, finishing 11th. The great Patrick Allen, future Hall of Famer, Walter Ray Williams Jr. Rhino Page in 16th, Parker Bone the third. John Zerbinski with another strong finish in a major, Ronnie Sparks Jr. making the top 24. Sean Rash, Dom Barrett, Mike Wolf, and Shannon Pluhowski, who replaced a couple of players that were injured and under the weather. Graham Faw strikes in the fourth frame. Classic 24
player field advancing to match play in the 24 games of round robin match play. And we're down to three players, each making their television debuts, Sam Cooley and Graham Faw. And Cooley, not a shaker in the bunch, opening three strikes in the fourth frame, looking to extend his lead in the Players' Championship semifinal match. Oh, tough break on the seven.
11 different countries represented at this year's Barbasol PBA Players' Championship. Three of them on this telecast. Sweden, Australia, Canada, represented here today on the show, along with obviously the U.S. Six women in the field. Highest finisher, as you alluded to, Shannon Pluhowski. A lot of striking this week. Big scores, big averages. And Sam Cooley with a 19-pin lead early on in our third match. Sam averaged 240 for the 24 games qualifying and 239 overall.
Oh, solid nine, gets it the second time around, slaps it off. Very different demeanor. Cooley is cool, steady. Just that one little burst in that last match. And one little burst right there.
Just start calling him Sam Cool.
Mm-hmm. Fought a cut into the lead, and he gets the messenger. Cuts it to nine.
And a nice break for Graham. That'll loosen the arm swing up as he catches that messenger.
Faw's goal since youth has been to turn pro. Parker Bone among his favorites.
He really has to wait on that arm swing from the top down. Anytime you see a player with slower feet, boy, waiting on the swing is a must.
And Bone, the defending champion here, finished 18th.
Come on.
Yeah, lead change. Faw leads by one. Cooley takes the early lead, and Graham Faw strikes right back. Australia versus Canada. And one international player will reach our title match versus Ryan Simonelli. We'll find out who when we return to Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl. Halfway through our semifinal match, opening turkey from Sam Cooley. And Graham Faw responds with a turkey of his own to take a one-pin lead. Cooley up sixth frame, can take the lead back with a strike. Six wraps the 10.
Nice carry, nice pin carry there. Looked like it was going to be a ring and 10 for just a second. Six pin catches just enough of it on its way by. There you go.
Sam Cooley's best previous finish was tied for 33rd last week in Indianapolis at the USBC Masters. And that was his best finish of 2016. His best career finish was 11th in the PBA Cheetah Championship in Reno. He's already exceeded all of those former achievements. Seventh frame. Double 19-pin lead and a little fire from down under.
Yeah, he's becoming a handful. And he's getting a handful at the bottom of the swing. A beautiful release. Talk about heavy hand.
Kimberly Pressler is laneside.
Thanks, guys. I'm here with Jesper. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with me. Why don't you tell me what happened between the first and second match for you?
The first match, the lanes were pretty similar. The second match, the right lane was starting to hook a bit early, and I tried to move in, and I threw the ball a bit too fast, and Sam didn't allow any mistakes because he could bowl a great game. So, yeah, you can't win every time, even though you want to.
You know you can, but thank you so much for taking the time. I know you got a flight to catch, so we'll let you guys go.
Thanks.
Guys?
Well, he's not going anywhere because guess what? I'm his ride to the airport.
Interesting about Graham Font, Randy, he's a natural right-hander, but he bowls from the left side.
Yeah, I thought that was amazing when he was telling us that the other night.
Hook a lot, yeah. And it's a strike and a lead change. Graham Font leads by one.
He actually started bowling at age 5 using a two-handed style, but converted to one hand at age 12. And just when it looked early on like his bar reaction wasn't going to be good enough to compete in this match, well, guess what, folks? He's got 5 in a row.
Oh, solid 9.
So.
Ball was just a little heavy in the pocket, but this is not a very good break. 46 feet of oil and not a lot of back end reaction going through the pins, but you can see that ball just going right by the 9 pin. And that couldn't have happened at a worse time.
We enter the foundation frame. Australian Sam Cooley. Canadian Graham Faw. The winner will advance to face Ryan Simonelli in the Barbasol PBA Players Championship title match for a major title and the third in a row here on the PBA Tour. Cooley trails by 2 pins. Great result, mixing strike.
Yeah, that was big there. Errant shot that comes back and strikes. That's all about how him and Norm Duke set up this pair on the right side. Watch this. He hates it. It's wide right, and look at how far back that came. On this pattern, that just didn't happen. But no matter what, he cannot shut out Graham Faw. Graham Faw controls his own destiny here in the 9th and 10th.
Good.
Real good. Strike for Graham Faw.
Real good. What a beautiful shot. And again, we talked about it earlier. This is a player competing on television under the bright lights on ESPN, PBA Tour, for the very first time. His first ever game on television, and he's doing this. Spare, strike, spare, six bagger. He can strike out for 270.
That's good.
Oh, 8 pin. The mirror image of Cooley's 9.
And now he's in jeopardy of losing this match. Spare strike will give him 249 and force Sam Cooley to double in the 10th. Just like the solid 9 that Cooley left on the right lane, he goes just a little heavy and leaves the solid 8.
Spare and a fill from 249 for Graham Faw. And Cooley going through the mental process of what he will need to do to advance to the title match.
Here's another veteran move from a first-timer taking a re-rack and making Sam Cooley think about his first shot and his first shot in the 10th frame, taking extra time, and this is a fill shot. The count does matter. He needs to get at least 9 to force the double.
Another example, Randy, of the youth movement, fearless, focused, using all the tactics available.
Second re-rack. You're allowed 2 a game.
Taking them both.
Icing his opponent.
I'm good.
Present in the moment, aware of his options, and exercising them. In his national television debut, Grandpa Phil for 249.
Uh-oh.
247, and why is that not good?
Because now Sam Cooley can go strike nine spare, and we have a tie.
Little extra time in the chair. Cooley with the solid nine here last time in the eighth frame. Trying to advance to a title match. Cured it. And look at that look at his face, Randy.
Very confident young man. He works hard at his craft.
Cook.
Right now. Cook. Hang on a minute. He's going to take a re-rack here on the right lane. And right now, he's just calling on his training, allowing his body to perform the way it's been trained to perform.
And very calmly asking National Tournament Director Kirk Von Kruger for a re-rack to collect himself. Strike for the win, nine spare. We would go to a sudden death roll-off.
Oh, no.
It's over.
Graham Faw has advanced to the title match. And Sam Cooley is going to think about that shot for quite a while.
Looked like he got really fast, and when you get fast, the tendency is to pull.
Canada's Graham Faw in his national television debut, looking to become the first Canadian to win a PBA Tour title and a major. Ryan Simonelli is in his way. Championship match uninterrupted is coming next. Time now for the Geico Championship recap with Randy Peterson.
And match number one was all about Jesper Svensson taking on the wee Iceman, Norm Duke. Using his power, he takes down Norm 274 to 258. And then it was newcomer, our second Australian, Sam Cooley, trying to win one for Australia. He takes down Jesper 246 to 206. And then in the matchup, you just saw another newcomer, Graham Faw, southpaw, trying to win one for Canada. He leaves the door open with a stone eight, giving Sam Cooley a chance. Sam needed strike nine. He got strike seven. Graham Faw advances to a great Barbasol championship match against Ryan Simonelli.
When we return, the Ryan Express, after an incredible close of the 2015 season, looking to cap off a first major victory in 2016. Uninterrupted, coming up. PBA doubleheader Sunday rolls on. The Barbasol PBA Players Championship title match is coming up next at Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl. Kimberly Pressler is with the tournament leader.
Thanks, guys. I am landside with Ryan Simonelli. Now, Ryan, you bowled a perfect 300 game in the last match for match play to cement your number one seed here today. How much confidence does that give you for today?
You know, it's a whole new day. I am confident, but I got to keep an open mind. This pair seems a little tricky with all the urethane and reactive going down a lane. So I'm just going to take it one shot at a time and just hope I make the right guesses.
All right, well, good luck to you today.
Thank you.
Guys, Ryan Simonelli is looking to win his second major championship here today.
The Ryan Express, Ryan Simonelli in the title match.
I found it interesting that he said that he finds this pair tricky. Graham Faw made them look pretty nice with the 247 game against Sam Cooley. And, you know, we're talking with Mike Edwards during the break, and there's no better feeling on the PBA Tour than coming through in the clutch in the 10th frame, and no worse feeling when you don't. And I can certainly sympathize with Sam Cooley. Now, one of the hottest players on the PBA Tour, Ryan Simonelli.
Tournament leader decides to start first. Opening shot, title match. He's a mixing strike.
Like a cruise missile going through balsa wood. That's a lot of power. Ryan Simonelli, fun to watch. Now, Graham Faw trying to become the first player ever to win a PBA title from Canada.
Back-to-back weeks, Dan McClellan tried last week. Faw has another opportunity today. Faw bowls in Kitchener with Dan McClellan. Opening shot is a good one. Strike apiece.
An all-southpaw finale. As you mentioned, Graham bowls out of Frederick Lanes, bowls league together with Dan McClellan. We saw Dan finish second last week.
McClellan, the general manager at the Fred.
The Fred?
In Kitchener.
I like that. The Fred.
Strike working second frame for Graham Faw.
Okay.
Mixing strike. Command of the pocket.
Nice soft little entry angle into the pocket on that shot, carrying the light mixer. Beautiful hand at the bottom. Again, a timing that really relies on waiting for that bowling ball from the top of the swing down.
Going to be interesting to watch the battle of will in this match. A softer approach, and the Ryan Express is bull charging forward, second frame. Double apiece. And today's Columbia 300 fun fact, and the age of the last four major champions, Simonelli at the U.S. Open, 29, Gary Faulkner at the World Championship, 25, and then the last 2 weeks here on the PBA Tour, Svensson, the youngest ever to win the Tournament of Champions, Simonson, the youngest ever to win a major at the Masters, 20 and 19.
Pretty incredible stat right there.
And it only gets younger today. Third frame.
Oh, baby, come on.
Tickles the six forward.
Simonelli just full of confidence, making great shots, and catches a nice break, and that'll loosen your arm swing up real quick. But he's really come into his own. Take a look at this form and this style right here. Look at that athletic position at the foul line. Beautiful.
Answers right back.
A battle of power and finesse. Ryan Simonelli, as much power as any of the two-handers out on tour. Difference, Ryan uses one hand in his thumb. Graham Faw, more of a traditional stroke type of player. Down and in is his game, keeping his hand underneath the bowling ball.
Just joined the PBA and just in bowling in his second career pro event, 2015 graduate at Urbana University.
Handball!
All strikes.
He's not supposed to do this. It's too early. This is only his first ever telecast. What's happening?
The youth movement is fearless and laser-focused. PBA.com. Be sure to stay logged on for all the latest PBA news, player updates, tournament results, and promotions, including the latest from PBA partner Barbasol. Just click on the Barbasol link at PBA.com for more info. Simonelli seven-pin roller comes up short and late.
My first ever time on television, it was in Tucson. I want to say it was 1985. I was bowling against David Ozzie. I shot 153, and it was all I could do to keep the insides from ending up on the outsides. And boy, it was a tough uphill battle from there and a big learning curve.
Speaking with Ryan Simonelli yesterday, always working to fight the demons within and the pressure to maintain what he's built. He's wearing the heart rate monitor today, 90 during practice. and it has shot up to 155.
Yeah, a little heart rate increase, a lot of adrenaline. That's what makes it fun.
And fun to watch. Fifth frame.
Good shot.
Yeah. High miss.
Really came into his own when he changed his game, working with Mike Jazz now. He shortened up that follow-through, that push-away in that first step, and really freed up his arm swing.
And the key for Simonelli was to incorporate those changes, Randy, while keeping his own identity. Now Graham Faw, four-bagger working, fifth frame.
Let's go, Graham.
Whoa.
Whoa. Oh.
Five-bagger. Any way they fall, something didn't look right.
Well, he wasn't expecting that much down lane reaction. But it's still a five-bagger. Watch this. As this bowling ball comes off the end of the pattern, it goes pretty sharp right. We haven't seen that much down lane reaction the entire day. Remember, 46 feet in length. The lane itself is only 60 feet long.
And Simonelli noting that Faw capable of generating more down lane motion. Perfect. Sixth frame.
Yes.
Slapping the seven. Graham Faw's got the front six. And Kimberly Pressler is with Sam Cooley.
Thanks, guys. Sam, thanks for taking the time to talk with me. That was a tough loss, such a close match. Walk us through what happened in the 10th frame.
I mean, I threw the first shot good and got up for the next one and just completely pulled the left. And I knew it straight away wasn't going to hold.
What do you see happening to the lanes out there?
It's going to be about who can hit the right lane on the left side. I think the way things are going now, it looks like Graham's going to go all the way, but Simonelli has the experience behind him, so he will have that to his advantage.
Well, thank you so much for your time. Thank Guys, you. Back to you in the booth.
Yeah, the big difference right now, and Sam just pointed out, is the right lane, and the difference in this match thus far, back-to-back, soft sevens for Simonelli.
Simonelli referring to his perfect game in the position round, Randy, as the most special way he's ever led a tournament. He even called it Barnes-esque.
Oh, yeah, there's no better way than he was referring to Chris Barnes, because he said that it seemed like any time Chris Barnes needed a big game, whether it was to make a show, make a cut, make match play, that Barnes came through with a perfect 300 game. But right now, Ryan needs to kind of back his ball speed down on that right lane to get it to face up.
Saying so, he said he didn't want to see that down lane shape. And a solid seven.
It's been the one stopper this week. The only thing that's really stopped the players has been pin carry. And it's been the difference between big games, matches won, and in a 220. You leave enough corner pins, you can hit the pocket every shot. And at the end of 10 frames, you shoot 220 versus 270. And it all comes down to pin carry. I think this is a real interesting shot coming up now on the right lane for Graham Faw, because remember the last time he was up on this lane, he was a little surprised by that down lane ball reaction.
Part of Faw's game plan is trying to ignore the circumstances. I don't know how you ignore front six in a title match. He'll operate in the seventh.
Oh, yes, there he is.
Just a wiggle and a 10-pin stance. Previous one, he didn't like strikes. He liked this one, no strike.
Looked like it was a little bit farther left of target down lane and a little softer off the pattern, leaving that shaker 10. Interesting spare shot, hooks it. He actually soft hooks it at the 10 pin. I can't remember the last time I've seen that. Everybody's so used to throwing it straight and hard at all single pin spares. Very interesting.
Graham Faw, 31 pin lead. We enter the eighth frame. Barbasol PBA Players Championship title match for a major on the PBA Tour.
Beautiful hand there at the bottom of that shot. Wow. Wow, that shot was so smooth and so clean off of his hand.
Thank you to Dean Bring, the Director of Partnerships at Barbasol, for their support of the Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Also, Wayne and Elaine Webb, the twosome, putting on a great show here in Columbus with the support of everyone here in the capital city. Shakes out the 10, Simonelli, big strike in the eighth. And now a monumental foundation frame coming up for the Ryan Express.
Ryan still has a possible 248 if he takes it off the sheet. Graham Faw is in the 240s. Take a look at the difference in the size of the left arm versus the right arm of Ryan Simonelli.
Come on!
And
never know.
Big double. Cuts the lead to 21. Graham Faw, Randy, steps up in a shutout situation. The last 2 weeks have seen the youngest major champions in their events. Graham Faw is 24, bidding to win the PBA Players Championship.
And we have the heart monitor. I'd like to get the brainwave monitor hooked up to these players.
Oh. High flush hit for Graham Faw. Doubles, extending his lead to 31. He can shut out Simonelli.
Yeah, and all he needs is a mark. Any mark here in the 10th frame, and Graham Faw will be the first player ever in the history of the PBA Tour to win for the great country of Canada.
All Simonelli can do is sit and watch. It's out of his hands. Clean frame, and Faw claims the Barbasol PBA Players Championship.
Terry, yes!
Graham Faw, three straight weeks on the PBA Tour, the first Canadian to win on the PBA Tour.
Oh, Canada. Wow, what a performance.
Graham's mom, Connie, is here taking in the PBA history. Randy,
wow.
3 weeks in a row, three historical conclusions.
Pretty awesome. Pretty awesome. Couldn't happen to a nicer young man. Really enjoyed our time we spent with him in our interview. Just a nice, nice young man. And boy, did he earn it.
From Guelph, Ontario, Canada. The first champion from the great white north is Graham Faw.
How about our last three majors? Wow.
Thank you, Tom.
Jesper Svensson, TSC winner. Anthony Simonson, Masters winner. And now, Graham Faw from Canada.
Oh, my God.
Connie, mom, and girlfriend Jenny. In support of Graham Faw and an incredible achievement. Almost 60 years of professional bowling and the first Canadian champion.
It's amazing, isn't it? You wouldn't think that it would take that long. Canada's got a lot of great bowlers. Dan McClellan, boy, with all his talent, we thought for sure he'd win a title. He decided to go home and get a full-time job. And now here's Graham Faw, who actually bowls league with Dan McClellan at the center that Dan runs. He wins.
And a runner-up finish for Ryan Simonelli, continuing the path of great bowling. But today's day is Graham Faw's as the Maple Leaf flies in Columbus. Kimberly Pressler.
Yes! Thank you, Columbus!
Will chat with the PBA Tour's newest major champion. And he might need a razor for the Barbasol shave when we return to Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl. It's the Horseshoe, Ohio State Stadium.
And this is inside Wayne Webb's Columbus Bowl and the conclusion of the Barbasol PBA Players Championship. Graham Faulk, how about 279, a winner over Ryan Simonelli to claim his first major title, the first ever for a Canadian on the PBA Tour. Down to Kimberly Pressler for our winner's presentation.
Thanks, guys. It's lively down here. Wayne Webb, would you please do the honors and present the trophy?
Oh, absolutely. This is great. For your first title, great bowling. Thank you.
Very much.
Wow, you earned this today, Graham. I see you got yourself a Barbasol face planner shape right now. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling great now. I got a nice smell to me right now thanks to the Barbasol.
Yes, you do. Now, let's talk about the fact that you made history today. You are the first Canadian to ever win a PBA title. How does it feel to make history?
It feels great. I mean, every time a Canadian's made a show, you always hear it, and it always fires us up, hoping that we can be the first. I'm glad it was me. I'm glad I could put on a show, and I'm glad that they made me put a score up. They bowled great.
Well, let's talk about the fact that you put on a great show, because you had some pretty high numbers today. A few of the guys, they struggled on the lanes a little bit, but you didn't. Why do you think that was?
Me, Brett, and Nick, we came up with a game plan, a couple game plans, just to attack the lanes different ways, see which one works best, and I'm glad we picked right.
And now I see that your mom is over there, and girlfriend got a little bit of them getting very emotional.
Of course.
What does this win mean to you?
And that none of the other left-handers could create. And then when it came down to the 10th frame where he needed to make the shot, he made it, and it was perfect.
The youngest ever at the Masters and the Tournament of Champions, and now Graham Faulk, the first Canadian ever to win on the PBA Tour. Big February and an amazing month of professional bowling. Coming up on the PBA Tour next, it's the World Bowling Tour Finals in today's PBA doubleheader, and then the Chris Paul PBA Celebrity Invitational. Oh, Canada! True patriot love and a championship for Graham Faulk, the first ever at the Barbasol PBA Players Championship. History made on the PBA Tour once again in Oklahoma, and last week and this week in Columbus, Ohio. For Randy Peterson and Kimberly Pressler, and for the entire ESPN production crew, this is Mike Jakubowski. More great PBA action coming up next. It's the World Bowling Tour Men's and Women's Finals.
Hey, Canada, you have yourself a new champion.